So first, what I want to know is, what was the reason behind, planning such a documentary? Whose idea was it? How did it come about? And how did you guys decide that, there are clubs like in Europe who have implemented this to perfection. So what was the reason behind, this documentary?
So I think one is, firstly, we obviously had a very good season. It was a complete turnaround from the first season, and also this we didn't have any really real interaction with the fans. That was impossible for us or any other teams this entire season with the COVID bubble. And we just felt it is important for fans to sort of understand the journey, how we prepared for the season, and what happens behind the scenes or in the bubble. So we just felt it was important for fans to sort of understand that, and also connect better. That was really the reason behind it. And also obviously there was a massive turnaround, so we just felt the timing was perfect for such a series. And I think our media team did a excellent job. Mayur, and his team with Surya and Akash, I think put together a really good series so far. And I think we've just done with half the season now, and hopefully the second half, the remaining episodes will be even more will be even better. So I think it's just a timing of it. And I think purely because we had no other way for sort of fans to know what was happening behind the scenes, I think this was extremely important. And we obviously knew we couldn't do it in the scale at which some of the bigger clubs in Europe or across the world do it. We knew our limitations, and I think we sort of made best use of the the footage we have. And I think it just came out really well, and hope all of you all liked it.
Yeah, well, I'm not being disrespectful to the sport that has given me a job, but what I do is in my off hours, I don't usually read or watch much of football. So right. Now that I've become a Indian football journalist, I don't really follow European football as well. I'm just concentrating on Indian stuff.
Indian football, right.
Yeah. So I've not watched many documentaries. I've watched the All or Nothing series.
Yes.
And apart from that, I've been watching the Hyderabad FC one as well. So every time Supreet sends us this press release, it's an indication for me to watch the next episode. Actually, that's the first thought that crosses my mind. I should watch it first. So yeah. So there are, I think, 4 episodes now. I was just looking a while ago. Usually 1 episode per week it is. But I think in the past couple of weeks, no episode was released. I was wondering if I missed something. So when I checked right now, I saw a comment below the 4th episode. Where is the 5th episode? The fans are already asking. So it's a cue for you guys.
No, so I think, so we actually didn't, obviously we didn't have a sort of, we didn't know how well it would be received actually when we were first planning this. Just that, we've sort of had 4 episodes, and I think we're just taking that extra bit of time to sort of improvise and, make the remaining episodes better. So that's the only delay really. So, but yes, we will have, we will have the next one very soon.
All right, that's good to know. So I know that, you have a lot of restrictions when it comes to, putting game footage, especially because the footage belongs to Star FSDL. Yeah. Even clubs are just allotted like a very small portion of every game. That's what I've understood. So how are, how have such, problems or, what can I call them, such setbacks, how have they affected you in making this video? So right now I see one video, one episode is about 11 minutes long. Most of it is, back BTS stuff, what happens on the training grounds, interviews of players, coach, but very little game footage is there in every video. that's obviously due to the limitations that you face. Can you just take us through that part?
Correct me if I'm wrong. I think this is the first time we could have access to the sort of match footage.
Yes. Yes.
So it is definitely important to, you know, sort of have access to the footage. But also, I think just with the and I think, you know, how you sort of utilize it, I think is important. Like, yes, it could be maybe just maybe 5 minutes of a game or 30 minutes or 50 minutes of a game. I think what you can do it and how well you utilize it, I think becomes the most important thing. And I think that's where we sort of maximized it extremely well. But just, you know, maybe, I mean, obviously we've, you know, there's got to be a benchmark. And next time when we do it for the next season, we will probably start planning now, because, you know, the series which we did now was pretty much sort of planned after we pretty much towards the end of the season. But this year, you know, we'd probably start planning now for next season, so that, you know, we have enough footage right from, you know, now till maybe, you know, whenever a couple of months down the line when the season starts. In that case, you know, we could probably, even if we have the same amount of footage available to us, we could still sort of capture every episode in a much better way. And also maybe, you know, increase the length of the episode. Like, since you mentioned the All or Nothing series, I think most of them are minimum of 30 to 40 minutes.
Yeah, 45 minutes.
So, again, even there, yes, there is match footage, but there is so much happening behind the, you know, behind the scenes. So I think that's something which we didn't have too much apart from interviews. But I'm sure, you know, with better planning, you know, I think we should be able to sort of offset this sort of advantage or disadvantage with, you know, a limited usage of match footage. And if I'm not wrong, I think we would have sort of maximized the availability of the footage. I'm not sure if we sort of underutilized it. No, so Hari, so I think we would have sort of utilized it to the maximum. Yes, again, you know, to your question, whether this is enough or not enough is, you know, that's a sort of a secondary question. But I think at least there's been a start. I think that's the most important thing. And I'm sure we can be sort of creative and improvise better and sort of make it a much bigger series for the next season.
Yeah, well, my next question was about, you know, whether there is going to be a continuation next season as well. So you've already answered that question. So can we take it as a sort of an official announcement that season 2 is coming?
Yeah, I think this is sort of definitely given us a lot of encouragement that, you know, we should continue and we should make it bigger for sure. So again, in the last couple of weeks, you know, I think we've got a lot of good response, not just from, you know, the comments from fans, etc., but just from our interaction with the league as well. It's sort of taken very well. And I think more than if we'll do it next season, we'll definitely will do. I think it's, you know, at what scale we should do it. I think that's really something which we'll have to think about. But yes, I think it's been very good. And I think the team's done a great job on this.
Yeah, definitely. I loved, you know, the episodes were short, but that doesn't matter. I was able to pay full attention. It has been a very good series so far. And yeah, fans are already asking for episode 5. So I'm also waiting. Yeah, well, I'll now move on to the secondary questions. But this is also related to what I saw in the series. So in the first episode, you know, you are there is this part where you are discussing the arrival of Sujay sir as the you know as he comes in charge. There's this particular line that he says. I'll just read it. He said that it was after his arrival that the club started planning not only for the season that was, but also for the, you know, coming years ahead. So it's been 1 year. It's been more than a year later since his arrival. He arrived in December, I guess, 2019. So it's almost been 1.5 hours. So, are you guys on track? What I want to know your take on, you know, it's been 1.5 years. So, are you guys still on track with what was planned at that time? A lot of stuff has changed, you know, with COVID and all. So, yeah.
So, I think, I think there were a couple of, the different components. Like, I mean, obviously, there is the first team. And then you have your reserve, U teams, and the academy part. Obviously, in terms of the first team, yes, we've progressed well. I think what we wanted to achieve, it's we've been extremely happy on that front. I'll just give some examples with the first team. I mean, again, you mentioned, you know, him coming, you know, on board in December. And the reason why I was keen to bring him then was because in a couple of weeks, we had the Jan transfer window to sort of make changes. Not just, I think we had about 6 games left then. But it was really to sort of, you know, make changes then, and which would make it easy for us, you know, in the summer transfer. And if you just look at the players we brought in then, it was Shaovik Chakravarty, who wasn't, you know, the first choice at Mumbai City. Liston wasn't playing too many games with FC Goa, and again Liston was contracted with FC Goa, you know, for the fact that we were able to you know, sort of sign him on a free transfer on a two-year deal was extremely, you know, was an extremely good decision. And Hitesh was another player who wasn't playing too much football. He was, I think, training with Odisha for a couple of months, but didn't really sign a contract there. And if you look at it, these three players, you know, played an important role. I mean, for the remainder of games, yes, Liston did play, score a couple of goals, but those signings actually turned out to be crucial. Yes, Liston, we did end up selling now. Obviously, from a business point of view, it was extremely good, and it sort of encourages us that, you know, that's the sort of model to look at as well. And but apart from that, I think we've we did well in that December at the Jan transfer, and obviously in the summer window we signed players like Sana, who's now gone to he's with the national team now. And we always knew we had some really good young talent like Ashish Rai and Yasir, who played a lot of games in 2019-20 season. And I think Sujay and the team were instrumental in, you know, signing these youngsters from the Arrows team, Mishra, then Biaka, who's not played a game yet, the goalkeeper, and Rohit Danu. Danu again is an amazing talent, and we'll definitely, you know, with obviously Liston not there, we will see a lot of Rohit Danu next season. So I think from the first team point of view, I think we've done extremely well. And also when we were, you know, sort of looking at you know, sort of targets for the first team last season, we obviously, you know, from being last the previous year, you know, I think to have a target to become champions was not was never realistic. We knew we had a good competitive team which would need a year to sort of improve, and then subsequently, you know, really start competing with the best teams in the league. And when we looked at our target was, you know, till the last round, last game for us, we should have a chance to, we should be in contention for the playoffs. So we did exactly that. It went down to the wire, and even in the last game, we took it to the last second. So I think from that point of view, it was a very satisfying season. Obviously, with the reserves and the U teams, with COVID, it's really been a start-stop. Again, this year, you know, when we thought things were going back to being normal, we did trials in Hyderabad, then also in the Northeast in a few regions. And now everything is again, you know, sort of gone quiet. So I feel that's the only place where we're sort of lacking behind. But again, in terms of the academy, we have made progress. And I'm fairly confident that, you know, in the next couple of months, we will have our own facility, sort of an academy facility finalized. It need not be our own facility, but we are in talks with a couple of institutions which is exploring, you know, different models where we can partner them. And in the next couple of months, I'm pretty confident we will, even though we won't probably get off to a start this year, but at least the foundation, you know, sort of will be laid for the upcoming season.
All right. Thank you. That was a very detailed explanation. Thanks a lot for that. Well, my next question is about something that I personally would also like to hear. But again, I think the fans also have a lot of questions on it. It's about the two partnerships that you have,
right?
One with Borussia Dortmund and one with Mabea. So can you just kind of, you know, explain the most important aspects of both partnerships? I mean, how do they differ from each other, and what are the most important aspects that you are supposed to look for in both partnerships?
Right. So yes, so the two partnerships are have, you know, certain different targets completely. With Borussia Dortmund, I mean, we were looking at, you know, their involvement and expertise completely at a grassroots and a youth development stage. It has nothing connected to the first team, at least for now. Again, for us, what we saw in the first season, because we were also fairly new to the market, there's a massive interest at the grassroots level. I think at school level, the participation levels are extremely high. And we just knew that we needed a strong partner which has expertise in grassroots and known for their youth development. And that's the reason we, you know, signed a partnership with Borussia Dortmund. And again, since we're starting from scratch, we wanted a partner to come in at that stage so that, you know, we don't start something on our own and then we have a partner with, you know, who suggests us a sort of a different model or a different direction. And with Mabea, Mabea FC, we've got one of the best training facilities in Europe. Some of the top clubs, you know, use that facility for pre-season or in the winter break. And also they are in the Segunda B division. And if you just look at ISL, you've got a number of foreign players, you know, who've got a lot of experience in that division in Spain. So from that point of view, we just felt it's more relevant for the first team. Well, again, last year and this year, I think even this year, we wouldn't be using the facility now. But the idea was really for, you know, some of our players to train there during the off season, not just the first team players, but a certain number of slots for players from every age group in the youth teams as well. Again, we were going to explore possibilities of, you know, players from that division to come and play for us in the first team. But again, just with the way the situation has been after we signed the two partnerships, it's been extremely slow. But again, both the partners fully understand the current scenario, and we're trying to do the best, you know, what we can do at this stage. For example, I think with Borussia Dortmund, because they're a well-known brand across the world, we will start doing a lot of activities or activations on digital in the next couple of months. While, you know, the more effective way, you know, for this partnership would actually be them, you know, being in Hyderabad, you know, working with kids and the coaches. But you know, we will just see what can be done, you know, really like how we're speaking at the moment. But the two completely different partnerships. I mean, one, as I said, is completely targeting the grassroots. When I say grassroots, it a lot of focus on coach education, because I think that is like one of the key areas to focus on. Whereas Mabea, again, it's there's a lot of relevance, you know, to ISL and Spanish third tier or the second tier. I think they were very close to, you know, getting promoted last season. But yes, I think there's a lot of opportunity for first team players to train there. And it could also be like, you know, player on a loan from there, at some point of time. So I think those options are open. I think we just need one clear season where we can, you know, really kickstart activities. But with the Borussia Dortmund in the next couple of months, there will be a lot of, activations between the two clubs.
All right. That's great to know. Well, my next question is about the two people, I think, who played a very important role in the first team, Albert Roca and Manolo Marquez. So, obviously, Albert Roca came in. He did a lot of good things for the club. But unfortunately, he could not stay on because he moved on to other assignments. And you got a equally good replacement in Manolo Marquez. So, can you just speak about, I specifically would like to know about how, the situation was at that time when Roca was leaving. Because it struck even like I am personally a fan of Kerala Blasters, obviously, because I'm from the state. But it did strike us too at some. Albert Roca is not a unfamiliar name. Yeah. Everyone knows how great he is. So it struck everyone, all ISL fans. It struck us at some level. So I would like to know how the situation was at HFC when that situation happened.
Yeah, so it was definitely tough, but in a way, the timing of the move was I think just a couple of weeks before everyone were going to assemble for pre-season. I feel maybe it was good and bad, the timing, because it really didn't give us too much time to think about what was going to happen. So we knew we had to move quickly, and from that point of view, I think it was okay. Otherwise, maybe we would have had to go through a long list of coaches to interview. The process might have been much different. I think we were very lucky to get a profile like Manolo. Obviously, it would have been much better. It is usually better if you spend a little more time, interacting with the coach, understanding his philosophy, etc. But we...
Can I just ask something? I've not been able to confirm this from anywhere, but are those two people related?
No, I've heard so. No.
They both have a same name, Roca.
Yes. No, not at all. I don't think they've, I think they've just met once or twice before.
Okay.
Yeah. No. So I think there was, I'm not sure if this is, this was where they met, but I think our assistant coach, had a camp organized or something, and that's where they met. Albert and Manolo, but and that's why Albert knew Manolo's name. So when but definitely not related.
Okay, so can you please continue? I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. No, so I think it was so we were very lucky to get a profile like Manolo, and I think we just had maybe two conversations, two detailed conversations before we signed, and I think the other important thing, again, just looking at with the time constraints, then we knew someone who had the experience to sort of continue, what we sort of put together. Then we didn't have time where, we have a coach coming in and making a lot of changes, because we knew it was just going to sort of, spoil the start of the season. So I think from that point, Manolo was extremely understanding. He knew exactly what the situation was, and he knew that we signed most of the Indian players and majority of the foreign players. So that understanding was extremely important, and Manolo worked with the sort of team he had. And again, I think just after a couple of weeks after he started working with the club, where he and Sujay were obviously in touch on a regular basis, I mean, he went through a number of videos with you know, some of the Indian players, which we shared with him. And yeah, he was actually spot on with quite a few you know, players. For example, Akash Mishra is a player I've never seen in. I mean, I've not actually seen too much of Akash Mishra. I've just seen highlights, you know, when he was playing for Arrows in the I League. But the first name, you know, when we had a discussion with Manolo after he took a look, had a look at all the Indian player videos, the first player's name he mentioned was actually Akash Mishra. He went on to say that he will be a very good fullback, and in the next few years he will play for India. And I think within 12 months he's in the national team. So he got it spot on. He did. He spoke extensively about Hitesh and Shawik as well. So it was a good start. It was a good start with Manolo, and all this was before he actually came to India. So we knew you know, we found a good coach, and we were hoping that we would have a very good season, and we did just that. But yes, just that transition was at a tough phase, but I think everyone sort of played a part to make that transition extremely smooth, including Albert. I think Albert and Manolo spoke for quite a long time, and I think Albert gave his feedback and views on the players and the reason behind every player's selection. So I think that that really helped, and it was, I think overall it was handled extremely well.
All right. Well, so now we'll go to the regular season. So, yeah, I mean, coming from a rival, this should be great. But yeah, Hyderabad FC did very well, exceeded all expectations. They were one of the fans' most favorite teams all season. But what I specifically would like to ask about, and which was also, you know, focused in great detail in the documentary, was a small set of incidents that happened after the loss against FC Goa, where Manolo Marquez, he in the post-match press conference, he took the blame on himself. He said, maybe if I was the owner, I would sack the coach. So, and afterwards, you were saying, we did not hear about this earlier. So, can you just let me know what happened at that time? I mean, what were your thoughts when you first heard this stuff like that?
No, so I, well, I think obviously we were, you know, that disappointment was there, and it was the third defeat in a row. And I thought, you know, generally in that game we were playing quite well. I mean, we were leading, and obviously conceding in the end, it's hard to take. And it was also the last game of the year, so we wanted to obviously end the year on a high. But I think it was just more the disappointment of the defeat. I think he felt, you know, a couple of substitutions, you know, he probably should not have made. And I think Manolo is an extremely honest person. I think everyone were sort of looking, always look forward for his post-match, you know, interactions. I think he and Shabba Laszlo of Chennai, I think they were the two managers everyone looked forward to. No, so I think it was just Manolo being extremely honest. And yes, we were at the stadium, so we didn't really you know, pick up what he said, and we were just told about it later. And but you know, we just had a laugh about it. The performance, even though it was three defeats in a row, we didn't sort of play badly. We just thought, you know, the first out of the three defeats against Kerala was not the best game we played. It was probably the worst game we played the entire season. Again, the game after, which we lost to Mumbai, was we knew Mumbai is going to be a tough team, but we still competed quite well in that. And and Goa was disappointing, but we were still happy. We just knew that, you know, I mean, when we interacted after that, we knew it was just you know, matter of one win, you know, before we sort of you know, sort of get on a good run. And luckily, you know, we started the new year extremely well with a big win against Chennai. And I think, you know, there was a lot of positivity within the camp. So there was nothing to worry then. I think, and that was just our communication to Manolo as well, that, you know, we just needed to, you know, just begin the new year well and just focus on the remaining games.
Yeah, well. From he said that in December, but in what, 3 or 4 months, he earned himself an extension. So
extension.
Good job by him.
He worked extremely well with the young players. We had quite a few of them who did not have too much experience in the ISL. Not just players like Rohit Danu and Akash Mishra, but even players like, Sana, to go on to become, the number one center back for the team is a big achievement, because, you obviously had seniors like Adil Khan to sort of compete for, that spot. I think he got the best out of the Indian players, and it was it was an amazing team. I think I think a lot of the foreigners, they were leaving as well, did mention that this was one of the best groups they've sort of been part of. I think it was just a great team performance, not just Manolo, but I think it had a lot to do with the players, the support staff as well. So yeah, it was good.
Well, we'll move on to another important set. As you said, the youngsters in the team. I'd like to hear your thoughts on all of them. Like you said, we Hyderabad is a very good set of youngsters. Ashish, Hitesh and all. So, can you just give us your thoughts on them? Just in general, maybe a few lines.
Yeah, I think just going back to the first season, we had youngsters like Ashish and Yasir who got a lot of game time. I think to start with, we knew, when Phil Brown was there, he was mentioning that, they're extremely talented youngsters. But we weren't too sure if they will actually, start as many games as they did that season. I think a lot to do was due to injuries to some key players that season, and these two players especially made full use of the opportunities they had, and that really helped, because we had two youngsters coming into this season with a lot of game time, they sort of grew in confidence, and I think they had an extremely good season and a very consistent season, because sometimes you have young players, do well one season and, drop slightly the next season. But I think Ashish and Yasir were exceptions this year, and, they were extremely high on confidence. I thought Ashish had some really good games, and same with Yasir. So I think that really helped. Ashish was unlucky in the end with his injury. So he, I'm assuming he would have had a national team call up as well. Very unlucky with that injury towards the end. And again, some of the other players, Manolo, as I said, Manolo was extremely confident with Akash Mishra. I think he was the only one for us, I think, to play every single game last season. And again, he's just 19, I think, so he's got a long, long way to go. And again, I just hope, he just goes from strength to strength and has a better season next year. I think that's got to be the target. Yes, again, the same thing with Liston. We all knew he had a lot of talent. In fact, I remember watching him when I was at Kerala Blasters, when we saw a couple of Santosh Trophy games in Goa that year. And we knew he was going to sign for Goa then, and he unfortunately didn't get the number of games he would have liked in Goa, but I think he did extremely well for us, took the opportunity as well, even though he's with ATK Mohun Bagan now, I think he's got great talent, and I think he'll do extremely well for the national team going forward. Hitesh was one of the best players to watch. Again, I saw Hitesh, play when he was playing under Steve Koppel at ATK, but didn't get too many games there. But I think it was extremely good to watch in that midfield, and Danu took his chances. I think he made a couple of important contributions. When he came on as a sub, I think one was against Bengaluru, and also part in that goal against East Bengal, I think, in our second game against them. So yes, I'm pretty confident Danu again will sort of emerge as one of the top youngsters this upcoming season, and I just hope he takes the opportunities as well as all the other youngsters have done. Sana, again, I think he's the he's senior compared to the others, though he's only 23-24, I think.
Yeah, he's 24.
So, again, he did extremely well, and I think he's I think he was one of the finds for us last season, and again took his chances well. He played very few games for FC Goa. I think the only start he got the previous season was against us, and he was the hero of the match in that game. I think he's he fits extremely well, I think, in Manolo's style of play, and I think that's what Manolo really liked with him. And I think him and Odeh formed an extremely good a center back partnership. I think the entire season we made very few changes in the back four, and I think that also really helped everyone.
Yeah, well, regarding the youngsters in the team, so now Liston Colasso has moved on to other opportunities. What I would like to know is, exactly is your model? I mean, you've been doing a good job developing these youngsters, but what would be your objective with them? Is it like develop them, make them better, sell them for a profit like you did with Liston? Or are you just developing them and building a team for a long time, a long-term vision? What would be your exact vision?
I think it's at the end of the day, I think it's important to have a sustainable a business model, and I think players sort of contributes a lot to the to this. Obviously, the league is growing, and we have been seeing player costs, salaries on the rise, and I think the important thing, as I said, is to sort of focus on your new development part, and it's important to have players coming through the ranks. At this stage, because we don't have a sort of a fixed structure as yet, that will take a bit of time, because we can't expect a player from Hyderabad to straight away move into the sort of the first team. That will take time. I think it's got to be a mix of bringing in players at the right age, from other clubs at obviously a good value. In case of Liston, it was a free transfer, but it's important to sort of bring in players who we feel we can develop them into better coaches, because
Liston wasn't a free transfer, right? I think you got a transfer fee for him. He had a multi-year.
I meant when we got him from FC Goa.
Oh, okay. My bad. Sorry.
Yeah. So I'm saying it's important to sort of Hitesh didn't play games. Liston did not. Shawik was to a certain point that season, and we did well to sort of bring these players in without paying a transfer fee. So I think it's important to it'll be a mix of bringing in such players. Parallelly, we will sort of develop our youth development structure, and I'm pretty confident we will have players coming through our youth teams. And in terms of what the objective is, yes, I mean, I think when we obviously, I mean, again with Liston, if we just take the example of Liston, we one was obviously the financial part of it, but it's important that, you know, when you're replacing a national team player, we've got to have a backup or a good supply, you know, in terms of players in that particular position. And I think that's where, you know, Manolo and the team, we were confident that, you know, we had the right options and, you know, which we scouted for and within the existing team that could fill that position. So from that way, I think it's important to sort of balance it out. Because the idea is, like, you know, if we finish, we've just missed out on playoffs last season, and we obviously want to go one step forward, and we wouldn't want to sort of, you know, compromise that you know, by selling a player. So it's important to have that that right balance, and I think we've sort of we believe we got it right with the Liston. And I hope, you know, the youngsters who sort of take his place will do equally well.
All right. I understand that you have other commitments, so I'll just quickly wrap this thing up. Yeah. I just have two more questions.
No problem.
Uh-huh. One is regarding, you know, we've talked about the first team. But again, I'd like to equally talk about the reserve team and the youth teams as well. So regarding that aspect, I would like to know specifically about how well, you know, the likes of Thangboy Singto coach and Shamil coach, etc. have been doing. We like them very well here in Kerala. Mm-hmm. because of the work they've done with the team. I personally watched Kerala Blasters reserve teams while Singto coach was here. So I've really loved how he interacts with the team. He was here for the Kerala Premier League also this season, yeah. Scouting. So yeah, I think on one particular game, he actually remembered a goal scorer because he had watched him 3 years back, yeah. In another game. So he knows the players all very well. He works with them very closely. So can you just talk about that aspect? Can you just tell us about more about Singto coach and Shamil coach and the others in that department?
Yeah. So actually, when I was in Kerala, I think the first major recruitment we did that year was Thangboy. Again, I never you know, had a chance to work with him prior to that, but always, you know, I always had only positive things to hear about him. You know, with his work he did at Shillong Lajong. Did extremely well with, you know, a very young team there, and we knew we needed someone, you know, of that profile to sort of work with younger players. And I think not just one thing which stands out about Thangboy is the amount of work he actually puts in. Because I do remember instances where in Kerala as well, when we had a you know, first team game you know, in Kochi, you know, obviously it's you know, there's a lot at stake, a lot of pressure, you know, for a Kerala Blasters game or any ISL game for that matter. You know, he would actually be at a under 18 training session, you know, early morning the next day, because he would try to sort of maximize his time whenever he's in Kerala, otherwise, because you're always traveling for an away game. And again, since you mentioned, you know, the Kerala Blasters reserves, you know, that I think there was a extremely good team in 2017-18. You know, I mean, obviously that saw the emergence of Sahal into the first team there. Rakib played a lot of games, you know, that season. And I think the current reserves captain was also playing. I think Sharjaz was also playing. Playing there, so it was a very good season. I think the team finished top of the table in the I-League second division. It was a good season, and actually that year was the first time the Kerala Blasters had the U15 and the U18 team. We didn't expect too much from you know, from the teams, because it was sort of set up the teams well with Thangboy with the help of Shamil coach as well, and Ranjit was also there. And the U15s reached the playoffs, the U18s reached the finals that year. Coincidentally, you know, Thangboy's U18 team lost to Shillong Lajong's U18 team that year. Again, it was great watching the U teams there. And again, when we needed a profile at HFC, I mean, the first name which came to mind was obviously Thung Boy, and because we were quite clear that we had to develop our U teams, strengthen the U development structure, and I just felt, you know, there's no one better than Thung Boy. And again, as you mentioned, you know, he's a great personality, extremely good when he communicates with young players, and I think he gives them a lot of confidence. And I think Shamil, who's working with the reserve team and U18s, I think he sort of learned a lot through Thung Boy's experience as well. And I'm extremely confident that, you know, even again, he's a very young coach with a top license, and I'm sure he'll go on to do extremely well in his coaching career. I believe going forward, they will play a crucial role, you know, in HFC. Again, they are, you know, really itching to get on the ground and do what they know the best. But the best part about them is their commitment, and it's always 100%. You know, they are looking to, you know, do more and more work. And I enjoyed working with them when I was in Kerala, and it's the same now.
Well, my final question, it's regarding the HFC players who got called up to the national team. So, how proud are you about, I mean, obviously you are very proud of their achievement. So can you just speak about that in, I mean, a few sentences? Can you just?
Yeah, no, it again, like when, you know, when we started the season, we didn't really think that, you know, we should have so many players in the national team or anything like that. We knew we had a talented group of players, and we were hoping they make use of the opportunity. Maybe some of them would not have, you know, got as much game time with other teams, but from that point of view, where I would just say that, you know, I'm extremely proud that they made full use of the opportunities, and they fully deserve it. I think it was the first game, you know, when we played the two games last month. I got a message from Sana. I think he was just leaving for his first game, and he sent a long message, you know, thanking me that, you know, that it was part of his you know, growth story, and, you know, his and, you know, just thanking us for the opportunity with which, you know, he made it to the national team. So it was great. It was a great moment then. I think it was just when he was on the team bus or something for his for the national team game. But yes, I'm extremely confident that they will do well for the national team. And I think it gives a lot of other youngsters in the squad, you know, that I would say that encouragement and motivation to also work hard and you know, take their chances when it comes.
Yeah, well, thank you so much. Is there anything else that you would like to add to all that we've talked? If there's anything you can say.
No.
You know, in case I miss something important, and you would like to add something.
No, I would just say that, I mean, we're obviously a new club. We've not even completed two full years. But I think our focus is definitely on you know, the grassroots and the youth development bit, and I think that's a direction we will take. And obviously, you know, the fans want to see entertaining football, and I think that's what I think we have sort of done that. We have provided them entertaining football last season, and I just hope we continue. And I'm very confident with the players we have. And the Indian players and the foreign players who we will bring in, you know, people will, when they watch HFC, they know that they will be watching entertaining football.
Well, that's very wonderful to hear. Thank you so much, Varun, for your time. I am not taking any more of it.
No,
I hope this was a good session for you as well. I hope you enjoyed 100%. It as much as I did.
Definitely.
So yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much, Varun. No,
thank you so much.
Have a good day.
You too.
And you too. Stay safe and, you know, take care.
Take care.